Right, I've chosen my song and I'm ready to go. How do I do this? You're going to arrange Afternoon Delight.
Yeah.
For your children's choir.
Yeah, it's such a fun song.
Do you know what it's about?
Yeah, it's about sweets. Right?
Believe it or not, choosing the right song is what's going to make or break your arrangement. It might seem obvious, but if you've ever been stuck trying to make something work for your group when you know deep down that it's just not going to, you know how soul-breaking this can be. You can avoid this situation by thinking carefully about your song choice before recording or writing down even a single note. If you've been commissioned to arrange something, it's a different matter, of course, but if you're, for example, writing for an a cappella group that you run yourself, then it's worth thinking about your song choice before you commit to it. If you're watching this video, I'm assuming that you already have a song in mind. Maybe something you heard on the radio, or an old favorite, or even just something silly that you thought would be fun to perform. Now, ask yourself, why this particular song for this particular group? Will it suit the image of your group? If you're running a community choir with mostly elderly members, is a song like California Girls by Katy Perry the best choice? Would Gangsta's Paradise by Coolio really make a good choice for your children's choir? Also, be aware that some songs are controversial, so it's important to research your song choice. While it might be fun to choose some quirky or unexpected songs for your group, like Girls Just Wanna Have Fun by Cyndi Lauper for an all-male ensemble, remember that they're likely to want to keep using your arrangements in the future, and if you've chosen something that's hard to add to a program, you might not get much use out of the arrangement in the long run. Song choice goes beyond the group as well. You need to think of the venue where the song is likely to be performed. In general, slower and quieter songs will work better in a concert space, like a church, as there will be less distracting elements around, and the audience can really take in the emotional depth of the song. If a performance is outside, maybe at a festival, choosing something loud and upbeat will probably make a better choice, as you're less likely to get drowned out by the surroundings.
I've personally performed at festivals where we didn't have microphones, and there were large sound stages on either side with loud music. So suffice to say, you can easily find yourself in less than ideal performance situations. And then it's important to have arrangements that can cut across the noise. If you know that your arrangement is likely to be performed in loud surroundings, then I have some tips on how to arrange them to make them work as well as possible, which I'll cover at a later time.
Finally, you'll have to decide whether you'd like the arrangement to have a lead solo or not. The reason why you need to decide this right from the beginning is that a soloist can make or break a performance, and a good arrangement can't salvage a bad soloist. Think about your group, and whether there are certain people you have in mind for the solo. This will also give you some indication about which key to put the song in, as the song definitely has to be in a good key for the soloist. Remember, you don't have to use the soloist for the whole song, maybe just the first verse and chorus. But it's still important to decide if you should use a soloist at all, right from the start.
I'm going to assume that you've made your song choice now. Are you sure? Are you extra sure? Remember, arranging takes time, and you're going to get extremely familiar with the song going forward, almost to the point of getting a bit sick of it. The more you arrange, the less time it'll take, but in the beginning, it can take a long, long time. Don't worry, we've all been there. The next step is to learn and internalize the song. What does this mean? Well, basically, you listen to it a lot. Like, again and again,
thinking about the structure, what's going on in the background, if there are any important melody lines happening apart from the main melody. Basically, what you're trying to do, apart from learning the song, is to find out what the song is. What I mean is, what makes this song? What makes it stand out? Two obvious features are the melody and the lyrics, but there are other things that can define what a song is as well. For instance, if I ask you to think about George Michael's Careless Whisper, what's the first thing you think about? Is it the verse?
I feel so unsure, so take your hand to the dance floor.
Maybe the chorus?
Now go and dance again. Guilty feeling, cut the rhythm. It's easy to pretend. So
well, what you're probably thinking of is... See what I mean? What I usually do is that I transcribe the song on manuscript paper, at least the melody and the chord symbols. This gives me a good visual outline of the song, and it makes me pick up on features of the melody very quickly, such as slides and syncopations. Another option is to record yourself singing the song, trying to match the timing and tone of the original singer. This can take some time, but it's going to be worth it when you get further along in the arranging process, as knowing the song really well can spark your creativity and make it easier for you to decide what's important to keep in your arrangement and what's not really necessary. Another useful thing to do is to listen to different versions of the same song to see how other arrangers have treated the song before you. You'll then hear what they thought was important to keep in the song, and they might even have had some interesting ideas in their arrangements that you can steal.
Borrow?
Okay, so I'm joking. But the copyright laws on arrangement are very lenient, and there's nothing stopping you from using other people's ideas in your own arrangement. After all, there's no need to reinvent the wheel. Even if you're not outright copying what other arrangers have done, you may get some ideas for transforming the song into something a little different from the original, depending on what you find. You may even get some ideas for a mashup, or how to deal with an extended instrumental section in a song. All in all, doing your initial research can only help you in the long run. Just be careful that you don't get too wild with your ideas, or it may get difficult to stitch it all together. Let's imagine that I'm running a choir and I want to make an arrangement for them. We'll say that it's a mixed community choir, so that means it has both men and women, and that there are some really strong singers in each part, but that it mostly consists of less experienced singers. They're all adults, they're roughly between 30 and 60 years old, and I've divided them into three sections, so soprano, alto, and baritone. We use a piano accompanist for our concerts, and she will need a part as well. She can read both notation and chord symbols. The song I've been thinking about arranging is Leave a Light On by Tom Walker. I've listened to it a few times, and I can kind of imagine my choir singing it, so I think it might work. What do I do next?
First, I'll have to check the lyrics properly, to make sure that the subject matter is relevant and that the theme suits my choir. Leave a Light On is about worrying about a friend who is struggling with drug addiction and trying to support them. I think this is a good message that will suit my choir, so I decide to continue with the song. I listen to it over and over, trying to get some idea of what the song is. It's mostly melody driven, but it has a prominent synth countermelody in the chorus,
which I want to keep in my arrangement. Most of the instruments in the track serve as accompaniment to the melody, rather than being independent parts, which means there might be some space to add something, maybe some reharmonization or counterpoint, if it suits the feel of the song. I also decide that I probably don't want a solo singer for the song. It doesn't really need it, and should sound beautiful with choral voices. Overall, it seems like a good fit for doing an arrangement. Until the next episode, I'll listen to it a lot, and seek out some other versions of the song, to see if there's anything else I can add.
Great! You're well on your way towards making your arrangement. Remember, the most common pitfall of arranging is not knowing the song well enough, so don't skip this step, or you may find yourself struggling to get ideas once the initial spark of inspiration disappears. Anyway, in the next episode, we'll start looking at how to adapt our song for voices. Let me know in the comments below about some songs you've chosen for your groups, and why you chose to do so. Even if it didn't turn out to work out well in the end, it's always good to learn from your mistakes.
Okay, then I'll take a good part.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.